Welcome to the service today. We're glad you're here, or whether you're watching online. We're thankful for all of you. Hope you've had just a great, great week this week. We've had some beautiful weather, and hope you had a chance to get outside and enjoy that. Well, today we are again visiting the life of Elisha, the prophet who succeeded Elijah. Got a double portion of God's blessings. He left behind his life of privilege and wealth, and for really a life of sacrifice and service to God. We will see God use spiritual blindness and actually spiritual sight to accomplish his will today, using Elijah in the process, or Elisha in the process. It's another interesting story from the Old Testament that we're going to look at. Once again, it points us to Jesus. Well, an exciting announcement. We are, it's officially open now. Kay's Blessing Box, Community Pantry. It's a box in front of our church that has some sort of emergency supplies for those in need in our community, and some personal items as well, that kind of thing. It's in remembrance of Kay Bender, and anybody that knew her and was a part of our church knew that she had just a heart for those that were needy. And so we're eventually here in a few weeks we'll dedicate that, and but we're just sort of getting it off the ground now. Really excited about it, looking forward to how God's going to use that in the future. I just want to let you know that that's up and running. Another announcement, we have a number of kids that are wanting to go to kids camp. They could use some help in going, and matter of fact, as a church, we're going to help pay for most of that for most of them. And so if you can help, we would appreciate it. You can drop it marked in the bucket in the back, or drop it in the mail to the church, or whatever. We just want all of our kids to be able to go that can go and want to go. And so just want you to be aware of that need. Well, let's pray together as we enter into worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity to worship together. We just commit this time to you and ask that you would be in our midst, that you would speak to our hearts, give us hearts that are ready to hear from you. We want to develop today spiritual sight that sees you at work. Lord, help us today. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, let's sing together.
Nothing is too difficult for thee. Nothing.
Pray together. Lord, we recognize that even now we are in your presence. We are on holy ground. You are with us today. And Lord, it's so wonderful. We thank you for that. We thank you for the reality of your presence with us today and every day. You are so faithful. You are so good. And we just praise you today. We are full of love for you, and we know you love us so much. You're so faithful, so full of love and grace, and Lord, whom shall we fear? With the Lord of angel armies on our side, with you on our side, who shall we be afraid of? There's no one. Lord, we thank you. We praise you, Lord. Give us courage. Give us eyes to see that you love us and are for us and are behind us and you are you care so much about us. Lord, let it spur us on to do things for you, do great things for you. Lord, lead us and guide us. Help us to love you unconditionally and grow together in your grace, Lord. That's what our heart is for you. That's what we want to see happen in our lives, in our church, Lord. We want more of you, more of your presence, Lord. Lord, we lift up those that are in need of a touch from you. We lift up Etta to you. We pray that you'll continue to be very near to her, Lord. Again, we ask for healing for her. She deals with a cancer, and we just pray, though, Lord, that you will be very, very close, very near to her and to Bev. And Lord, we just lift them to you. We also lift up Mary Kite to you. Be very near to her, Lord. Again, we ask for a miracle in her life. Just take the cancer away. And Lord, we just lift her up. We lift up Janetta as she continues to heal and recover from her fall. And Lord, we just pray you would encourage her heart today and just be very, very near to her. Lord, continue to be with Louise as she recovers from her heart ablation and some of the issues she's been having there. Lord, we just lift her up, put her into your hands, and just ask for your touch to be upon her. Lord, just help us in general as we continue to deal with the coronavirus, Lord. We just lift up those in the medical community, and we pray that you'd be very near to them, encourage their hearts. Lord, we thank you for the improvement in numbers, but we do lift up those around the world that are still suffering just huge ways. And we pray, Lord, that you would intervene in those situations, Lord. Lord, I thank you that my friend Chet Martin was able to come home this week. And Lord, just continue to bless him and be with his family, Lord. Just be very near to them. Lord, we lift up loved ones that are far from you. Lord, they need you. There are so many, and many in our culture, many in our world, in our nation, just need you. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to reach them. But Lord, just be very near to them. Draw them to you in these days. Lord, we lift up silent requests. There may be requests that we know nothing about, especially we think of those that are watching online today. There may be a burden that they have, a struggle they have, maybe a situation that seems hopeless. Lord, I pray that you would be, again, your presence would be very near to them. Help them as they work their way through that situation. Continue to be with our missionaries, Lord. Bless them, use them. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done, all that you're doing, all you're going to do. Continue to be with us in this service, Lord. Help us to fix our eyes on you, Lord. Thank you. We give you praise. We give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, before we get to the sermon today, we're going to sing another song together, a little chorus. It's appropriate to the sermon. Let's sing it together. Open our eyes, Lord.
Thank you.
Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. You know, without sight, there is so much to life that we would miss. We wouldn't know the beauties of color and or even the majesty of a sunset, the splendor of something like the Smoky Mountains, someplace that's near and dear to my heart, or the glory of looking out over the vast ocean. We wouldn't know the thrill that comes into our hearts from seeing the look of delight in a child's face or the affectionate gaze of a spouse. All of that's something, but to think about spiritual sight, really it's 10,000 times or maybe more than that, more important than physical sight. Spiritual sight is how we perceive God. And without spiritual sight, we miss out on the really what's the most glorious display in the universe, God's presence, his grace and his love and his faithfulness to us. We would miss out on all of that if we couldn't see with spiritual eyes. The tragedy is that if you're spiritually blind, you have no idea really what you're missing out on, that you're missing anything at all. You just don't know what you're missing. One of the most tragic curses in the fall was that our sin left us spiritually blind and not even really aware that we're blind. We became full of ourselves. We think mostly first of ourselves, and we think that we can see. The miracle by the prophet Elisha that we're going to look at today addresses spiritual blindness. Elisha, the double portion prophet, is really a foreshadowing of Jesus, the greatest of all prophets. Elisha's ministry was remarkable, doing things that no prophet that had come before him had ever done. But Jesus would even do them all and do them all to even a greater degree. Elisha's name in Hebrew means God saves. His ministry existed to demonstrate the saving power of God, and which of course all points us to Jesus, which means we need to read the story of Elisha through the lens of what Jesus accomplished for us. In Matthew 11:5, Jesus describes his own ministry, and this is what he says. He says, "The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor." Now it's interesting, as we've been looking for these last few weeks at the life of Elisha, we see several of those things happening in his life, but they all point us more and more to Jesus. So let's dig into our story for today. 2 Kings chapter 6, starting with verse 8. "Now the king of Aram," or Syria, as we said last week, "was at war with Israel. After conferring with his officers, he said, 'I will set up my camp in such and such a place.' The man of God sent word to the king of Israel, 'Beware of passing that place because the Arameans are going down there.' So the king of Israel checked on the place indicated by the man of God. Time and again, Elisha warned the king so that he was on his guard in such places." Now, time and again, when he's warning the Israelites what the Arameans are about to do. So the Israelites were always a step ahead of the Arameans in the battle. As you can imagine, that's a big deal. And so then we come to verse 11, and this is what it says. "This enraged the king of Aram." That's what you'd expect, right? "He summoned his officers and demanded of them, 'Tell me, which of us is on the side of the king of Israel?' 'None of us, my lord, the king,' said one of his followers. 'But Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the very words you speak in your bedroom." It's like he's tapped into their phone lines and into, you know, reads their emails or whatever. They don't understand how Elisha can know what he knows. Now, we know God had given it to him in some way, but anyway, let's keep going. "It says, 'Go find out where he is,' the king ordered, 'so I can send men and capture him.' The report came back, 'He is in Dothan.' Then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there. They went by night and surrounded the city. When the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. "Oh, no, my Lord, what shall we do?" the servant asked. "Don't be afraid," the prophet answered. "Those who are with us are more than those who are with them." And Elisha prayed, "Open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see." Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. As the enemy came down towards him, Elisha prayed to the Lord, "Strike this army with blindness." So he struck them with blindness, as Elisha had asked. Now we'll stop there for a second. So Elisha prays for his servant's eyes to be opened, and the Syrian army, for the Arameans, for their sight to be taken away. It's an interesting situation. Now, Hebrew scholars point out that this was not total blindness that the Arameans suffered. I mean, if it was total blindness, they would not have been able to move forward at all. Because it tells us, you know, they think they continue on in their mission, but they don't. And so, well, let me pull something sort of out of left field. Anybody know what annual holiday comes up on Tuesday? Well, it's Star Wars Day. It's May the 4th. May the 4th be with you. What Elisha does here, it seems to be a lot like what happens in those movies where they have what they call Jedi mind tricks. In Star Wars, the main good guys, the Jedi, would sometimes use these things, and they would use them to escape the bad guys. They'd wave their hands and say something like, "These are not the droids you're looking for." And the bad guys would suddenly be blind to reality because the drones that they were looking for were right there in front of them. And they were blinded to the reality. And the good guys would get away. They can't really perceive where they are or what's happening to them. They're in the current reality, but their minds are clouded to what's really going on. In verse 19, this is what it says. It says, Elisha told them, this is not the road, and this is not the city. You know, these are not the droids you're looking for. Follow me, and I will lead you to the man you are looking for. And he led them to Samaria. Now, interesting thing. Samaria is about a 10 to 12 mile hike from Dothan, even marching at a brisk pace that would have taken roughly probably at least 3 hours. It makes me wonder, what did they talk about on the way? What did Elisha and the Syrian commanders talk about? I mean, they've got 3 hours to chat. They might say to Elisha, so what is it you do anyway? And you know, well, I used to run a farm and haven't had time for that lately, but where are you leading us exactly? Oh, it's just up, nice place, just up here around the bend a little bit. Friendly people, barbecue is fantastic. It just makes me wonder. It had to be a little awkward for Elisha and for the Syrians. They're blinded to all this. They don't even realize what's going on. But yet, I think there's some good humor here. This is one of those stories that shows us that God has a good sense of humor. I mean, they are out looking to kill Elisha, yet here he is right there with them, leading them, and they don't even know it. They don't even realize. Samaria, by the way, was the capital of the northern kingdom of Israel. So it's where the king of Israel lives, and along with all of his army with him. So let's wrap up the story, starting at verse 20. After they entered the city, Elisha said, "Lord, open the eyes of these men so they can see." Then the Lord opened their eyes, and they looked, and there they were inside Samaria. This is the moment they all said, "Oh, crud," or maybe something worse than that. I don't know. They are caught. There is no getting away. It reminds me of one of my favorite old movies, Sergeant York, and maybe some of you are familiar with that. And Gary Cooper, the main character, well, he's playing Sergeant York, and he single-handedly captures a whole bunch of Germans during World War I. It's kind of like that with Elisha. When the king of Israel saw them, getting back to the scripture, when the king of Israel saw them, he asked Elisha, "Shall I kill them, my father? Shall I kill them?" Now, he says that twice, and that makes me think that maybe he's kind of giddy, like a schoolboy kind of thing. You know, can I? But Elisha says, "Do not kill them. Would you kill those you have captured with your own sword or bow?" In other words, you wouldn't just kill prisoners of war, would you? And these are not even your prisoners. They're obviously God's prisoners. And Elisha says, "Set," and this is a key moment in all of this, totally unexpected for the army from Aram. "Set food and water before them so that they may eat and drink and then go back to their master." So he prepared a great feast for them, and after they had finished eating and drinking, he sent them away, and they returned to their master. I like Elisha. One of the things I love about him, I mean, here's now at least twice, he likes to eat. Actually more than that, if you count he had the barbecue before he left to follow Elijah, and then he'd stopped at this one lady's house, this one couple's house, several times, so much so that they built a room for him, and I'm sure they fed him. He must have liked the food there. Anyway, he likes to eat. He likes to have parties. And I love the last line. It says, "And so the bands from Aram stopped raiding Israel's territory." Something had changed in them, and we'll get to that in a minute. The plot of this story really revolves around two sets of blind people. One is a believer, and the other is a group of unbelievers. And we're going to talk about both of these groups this morning. What both really need, though, is for their eyes to be opened, to receive sight for what they're blind to. Let's talk first about the blindness of the believer here. Elisha's servant was terrified because he saw the size of the Aramean army against them, but he was blinded to the presence of God who was fighting for him. The size of the army that he fought with, that God fought with, you know, the God of angel armies, as we sang about a little bit ago. Essentially, he doubts two things. First of all, is the determination of God's love, the how much God really cared about Elisha and the servant. And also he doubts the strength of God's power. He thought God had abandoned them. "Hey, we're surrounded here. We're abandoned. There's no hope. What can we do here?" Often the essence of sin for a believer is a lack of faith in God's goodness. The reason we reject God's ways and pursue our own path is we don't think God is infinitely good or trustworthy, and we don't trust him. We don't believe he's going to come through for us. The reason we are afraid or worried is we just don't believe in God's promises that he is good and that he is always fighting for us, that he will never leave us or forsake us, and he is working out all things for our good. We just don't believe it, or don't believe it enough. We don't believe it compared to whatever it is that we're facing. Religious people, believers like this servant, often doubt God's goodness and his love as much as unbelievers do, being constantly worried and fearful about their life, not trusting God. And it's a sin, and we need to be careful of that. Sometimes religious people show their unbelief in God's goodness by thinking they have to perform at a certain level before God will love them and accept them and bless them. They see God as an adversary who has to be won over through good works. It just doesn't work that way. That's not the way God works. That's not grace. So back to our story. In answer to Elisha's prayer, God opens the eyes of this servant to see the angel armies of God, these angel armies that surround this murderous horde of Syrians. And that this huge Syrian army is nothing compared to the millions upon millions of angels that God has at his disposal surrounding those that he loves. The reality is that when we are afraid, we need clearer vision. We need to see and understand God's love for us, which makes me think of Paul's prayer to the Ephesians in Ephesians chapter 3. And this is what Paul says. He's floating along in his book, and all of a sudden he stops and just comes out with this prayer. He says, "I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God." That's Ephesians 3, 16 to 19. That's such a powerful prayer. It's a beautiful prayer. But Paul does something, you know, as he's going along here, it's almost like you get the idea here that he just kind of loses his words. That's not something Paul normally did. He seemed to always know what to say and when to say it, but not here. He says this love that surpasses knowledge, it's so great, so amazing. I don't even know how to talk about it. I don't even know how to pray about it. He said, he wants us so badly to know that love, God's love, to recognize that God, for us to recognize that God loves us so much. And it's hard for Paul to explain, to say. He can't put it into words. So he says, "I'm going to pray that you might sense it in your hearts, to be able to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ." Let's break down those things a little bit. The length of God's love. How long is God's love? For in Ephesians 1, verses 4 and 5, Paul explained that from all eternity, God has set his love on us. This is what it says: "For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will." From the very beginning and throughout all of eternity, we are loved by God. That's a long time. Forever, right? I mean, it's a long time. How long is God's love? It's forever. The height. How high is God's love? David said in Psalm 103, verse 11, he said, "For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him." Now, you ever look at the stars? If we were to look straight up and see as far as we could see, forever, keep going to the height of the heavens above. Let me give you some statistics. I'll give you some numbers, and they're pretty big numbers. Light travels at 186,282 miles per second. In the time you snap your finger, light circles the globe six times. In 1 minute, light travels 11 million miles. It takes 8 minutes for light to get from the sun to our planet. So when you feel a sunbeam on your face, it left the surface of the sun 8 minutes ago. In one day, light travels 160 billion miles. In 1 year, light travels an unfathomable 5,865,696,000,000 miles. That's what's known as a light year. You may remember Buzz Lightyear. Well, that was making reference to this. What's a light year? Okay, 5,865,696,000,000 miles. The outer edge of the universe, according to astrophysicists, is 15. I still don't know exactly how big the universe is, but this is how far they're pretty sure it is. The outer edge of the universe is 15.5 billion light years. So 5,865,696,000,000 miles times 15.5 billion, whatever that is. How high are the heavens above the earth? Roughly 15.5 billion light years. That's the idea being, that's how much God loves you, how much he loves me. That number, that distance is really incomprehensible. It's unimaginable for us. It goes beyond what our brains can even begin to think. But that's God's love for us. That's how high it is. Let's talk about the breadth. How wide is the love of God? Again, we turn back to David in Psalm 103. It's the next verse. And still, it's in the context of God's love. And this is what he says, verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. So how far is the east from the west? Well, start walking east and see when you get to the west. You actually will never get there, right? Because you'll keep going east and east and east. And so really, you know, if you never get there, that means there's not any end to God's love. The breadth, the width of God's love. The idea is sort of that God's width, the width of God's love is wide enough to control all things. Anything you face, anything that comes your way, that comes at you, God's love is big enough to handle it. There's not one stray molecule in all the universe, or as we see in this story, God has thousands upon thousands of angels covering every square inch of this planet. What if we really, really believe that? The depth of God's love. How deep is God's love? Deep enough to reach into the lowest hell to save us. Romans 5, 6, and 8 says, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Oh, it's deep. It's plenty deep to save us from the deepest hell. God's love. If we could only grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, it's beyond words, that you may be filled to all the measure, to the measure of all the fullness of God. Everything that he is, all of his love for us. So to the believer, open your eyes of faith. Trust God's love for you. Listen to Psalm 34, verses 7 and 10. It says, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his holy people, for those who fear him lack nothing. The lions may grow weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. God loves you so much, beyond words. What if today our eyes were opened to how much he loves us and cares for us? Based on what we see here in 2 Kings 6, can you imagine what we would see? Do you have the faith to see that God is good, loves you, and is always fighting for you? Romans 8, 38 and 39 says, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate us from his love. If we spend any time at all in God's word, if we have even the faith of a mustard seed, we can say, if God is for us, who can be against us? If I'm facing an unbelievable struggle in front of me, I can face it with God's help. It's interesting to me how Paul in Ephesians 5:18, he sets up a contrast to being filled with the Holy Spirit and being drunk with alcohol. He says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Now, the thing is, both of those are ways to deal with your problems. Alcohol, though, it blurs your perception, your perception of reality. It helps us to drown out our fears and worries and sorrows. It dulls our pain. It does all those things. The Spirit does the opposite. He doesn't blur our sense of reality. He expands our understanding. He lets us see with spiritual eyes that the armies fighting for us are greater than those who are fighting against us. We can see God. We can know His presence. Sometimes we may struggle to understand how God is working, right? I mean, sometimes it's hard to know. And you know, I mean, I think about like even through COVID, why has all this happened this last year and however long it's been now? Kind of lose track. But let me point out a little detail that you might have overlooked in this story, but a Jew probably wouldn't have. It's in verse 10. And you ask, where did this vision take place? Well, it's in a place called Dothan. Any Jewish person would recognize that Dothan is the place made famous by another man of God who is in deep trouble, and that's Joseph. He had been thrown into a pit and then sold into slavery. That was at Dothan. That's what made Dothan famous. It's in that pit where Joseph prayed to, no doubt, prayed that God would deliver him from that situation. Did God answer his prayers? Well, yes, and you might say no, not in the way that he would have liked back then when he's in that pit, not in the way he expected. He's sold as a slave to a group of slave traders from Egypt. He's falsely accused by Potiphar, thrown into prison. He was forgotten by a butler. All these different things happened to him, but God was working through all that stuff to get Joseph into a place where he could rescue both himself and his family and really all the people of God. If God had answered Joseph's prayers from that pit the way that Joseph had wanted, all of Joseph's family might have perished physically and spiritually. Joseph couldn't see it. But God was working in all of it, working it all out. And that's how it may be for you sometimes. You may not see God at work. You may not realize what he's up to. But you can know that God is always fighting for you. Even when you can't track the footprints of his angels or hear the rumble of his chariots. For confirmation, we can look to the cross, right? Some wonder why God did things the way that he did them on the cross. And I am not God. I can't answer that fully. But I do know one of the things that God is doing, is always doing, is working in us, is perfecting our faith, is testing our resolve to our resolve in his goodness. You see, God is not just interested in resolving our physical situations. He's also interested in restoring our faith, building our faith, growing our faith. So often he makes struggles a part of the process. We need to look our whole life through the lens of the cross, of Calvary. I mean, you know, that we wouldn't have thought that Jesus would have had to have gone through all that, all those struggles, all those, you know, the beatings and all those things. But he did it for us. Calvary brings otherwise blurry situations into sharp focus of God's love. You see, he went through those things for me in my place so that I could be saved. Gospel eyes, Calvary kind of eyes, give us the ability to see a world filled with angels on horses and chariots, to see God's Spirit at work all around us in our life and in the lives of those around us. What we need is not a new sight of angels, but insight into the heart of God. Does that make sense? So often we see setbacks and we think of them as being permanent, you know, a broken relationship, a failure, or whatever. We think we're worthless. And we think there's nothing but failure and pain in our future. And that's all lies. Again, we go back to Psalm 34. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. We just need to trust God. Trust his goodness and recognize that he is there for us, that he loves us and will be with us no matter what we face. So that's the blindness of the believer. Let's move to the second group, the blindness of the unbelievers. How are they blind? Well, to start with, they think God and his people are the enemies, right? And if they can just capture and eliminate the man of God, then, you know, their problems are going to be over. So Elisha asked God to strike them with this blindness, which can be a picture of spiritual blindness. Remember, what God gives them is a delusion. They think they can see, but they can't really. Again, it's kind of a Jedi mind trick. But that's how the whole life of an unbeliever is. They think they can see clearly, but they can't. Elisha confounds them. He tells them that they're seeking the wrong person. He walks them into Israel's capital, which puts them into a completely indefensible situation, you know, vulnerable state. They're completely vulnerable. This is what God does. Paul says that he confounds the plans of the wise and brings it to ruin. This 1 Corinthians 3:18-20, it says, "Do not deceive yourselves. If any of you think you are wise by the standards of this age, you should become fools so that you may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness in God's sight. As it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows that the thoughts of the wise are futile." There comes a delusion when we are living in sin, a delusion that we can't see things as they really are. We think we don't need God, you know. I'm okay. You know, I'm good enough on my own. I don't need God's help. I don't need his strength or his power, his grace. I don't need any of those things. Our wisdom is really foolishness. That's not what Paul is saying there. And so often we don't know it's happening to us until it's too late. So Elisha, he confounds them and leads them to a position of complete vulnerability. But then something happens that no one would expect. He throws them a huge feast. He gives them a party. I don't know if it's another barbecue, but I bet it was spectacular. And then lets them go. When they finally snapped out of their blindness, they expected that onslaught of judgment, you know, oh crud, you know. Instead, Elisha gave them a feast of grace. Don't miss the irony here. They thought the resolution of their problems would come through capturing and killing, destroying God's man. Instead, they found blessing when they were captured by God's man. It's really fascinating. So many overtures, overtones of Jesus here. When Jesus came, everybody missed him. They couldn't see him. They were blinded. They were seeking the wrong guy, just like Elisha said to these soldiers. The Jews thought they needed a conquering warrior who would get rid of all their enemies and save them. When the real Messiah showed up, he served the poor. He washed feet. He died as a substitution for sin. They missed the real Messiah. Like Elisha, Jesus took his enemies into the heart of the capital, to the throne room of God's judgment, of God's justice. But instead of judgment, he gave them grace. Instead of calling down the legions of angels upon them in judgment, he prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." It doesn't make sense to those that can't see, that have this sort of delusion about the way things are. This is why the cross is foolishness, is the foolishness of God that confounded the wise, but it achieved ultimate victory. Ultimate victory is not to destroy your enemies, but to turn your enemies into friends. That's what Elisha did with these soldiers, and what Jesus does with us. It doesn't make sense from a worldly standpoint. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:18, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Because of our sin, we should be enemies of God, but because of God's great love for us, because of his grace, that's not what happens. We end up being the ones that are blessed, even though we should be the ones that die. The delusion of these soldiers is a picture of the blindness that an unbeliever has. They think that God is their adversary. He's out to get them. His rules are bad. They're restrictive or whatever. He doesn't care about them. He's abandoned them to the ravages of this life, of this world. The tragedy is that at all points, they think they can see, but that's not truth. It all seems so clear, but they're blind. It reminds me of what Jesus said to the Pharisees after he'd healed the blind man in John chapter 9. Jesus said, if you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains. If you knew you were blind, you would seek God for sight. It's because you think you can see that you have things, you know, think that you've got things figured out, that your guilt remains. Like these Syrian soldiers, you think you're going to find what you're looking for by capturing some earthly thing, a job or a relationship or a certain salary level or a level of fame or whatever. But just like in this story, you are blind. You'll only find what you're looking for when you are captured by God, by His grace, by His love, by His warm embrace. True joy is not found in anything in this world. It's only found in being reconciled to God. And so how has Jesus attempted to wake you up? He did more than simply throw you a feast and let you go. He took you into to the heart of the capital, but rather then taking vengeance on you, He poured out His love on you through Jesus. On the cross, He could have called down these legions of angels to deliver Him, but He didn't. He suffered willingly, turning His back on their help so He could save you, save me. And that should do two things to you. Number one, it should change your heart about God. And two, it should show you that you can trust Him, you can love Him. You see, all the previous prophets, like Elisha, had the angels by their side. Jesus was the only one who did not have them by His side. He was forsaken by them and by God so that He could save us. You know, Muslims have a hard time understanding that, understanding the crucifixion. You know, they wonder, why would God allow His servant to be forsaken? Well, we know why. We know it was for us, so that He could save us. Unbelievers see it that way, like the Muslims. You know, why, this doesn't make sense. This is foolishness. But it's through this foolishness that Jesus saved the world. These soldiers in 2 Kings were changed. Again, verse 23, so the bands from Aram stopped raiding Israel's territory. I think that's a pretty cool part to the story. It's an added-on sentence, but it tells us a lot, doesn't it, about how they reacted. And that was only from sort of the slightest touch of grace, being given a meal and freed, that kind of thing. The soldier by the cross was changed by seeing Jesus' grace towards him. He said, surely this man is the Son of God. What changes a heart? Well, it's having eyes to see God's presence all around us. Next week, Mother's Day, we're going to look at how we pray for prodigals. And a big part of that is to pray that the eyes of their heart will be opened, need to be opened. But it's amazing what happens when the eyes of our hearts are open, when they come alive, when they see God at work and are all around them. What happens, when that happens, grace is acknowledged and it turns God's enemies into His friends. Today, both the believer and the unbeliever, we need fresh eyes that need to see a fresh glimpse of God's love. Sometimes we seem to thrive, on Bible knowledge. We figure out what we know. We know our Bible. We know it really well. And we have a ton of head knowledge and that kind of thing. And there's nothing wrong with that. But sometimes we don't need more Bible trivia facts that we can spout off at the slightest moment. We know certain Hebrew words and Greek words and all those kinds of things. What we need is a fresh view of God's love. the love of God. We need eyes that are open to God's presence and God's goodness and God's love. We might say, oh, one real look at the cross is worth 10,000 Greek verb tenses or something. We need a real look at the cross. Jesus didn't die just to fill our head with information, but to fill our hearts with love. We need to see. If we go back to Ephesians 3, Paul ran out of words. So he prays in the middle of this book, this letter to the Ephesians, that God would allow them to see the height and depth and breadth and length of God's love. Paul knew all the teaching and all the study in the world can't produce spiritual sight. That's the life he had lived, right? That's the life he had had before. On the road to Damascus, he had all the Bible knowledge in the world, but he was blind to the truth of Jesus. God literally struck him blind to help him see it. God gives this kind of knowledge as a gift and as an answer to prayer. We need spiritual sight. We need eyes to see. To do that, we need to turn our eyes upon Jesus. In him, we see the gospel. We see that God did what we could not do. We see the height and depth and width of God's love. If you're a believer today, the servant could have looked at that hill all day long and not seen the first angel. God had to open his eyes. He had to see. Pray that God would open your eyes. If you're an unbeliever today, open your eyes to God's grace. He's not out to get you. He's not just waiting for you to mess up, to send you to hell. He's not waiting until you do enough, until you get your life all straightened out. He takes you as you are. All you have to do is turn your eyes upon him. He's waiting for you to just trust him, to recognize, hey, he's got it all figured out. He's got it handled. Put your faith in him and what he's done for you. As we close today, we are going to sing a song that you're familiar with, but it's a little different version of it. It's a brand new song. We're going to sing it in a new way. It's called Turn Your Eyes. Whatever darkness you find yourself in today, turn your eyes upon Jesus. But just one look at the Savior, you will find life more abundant and free. So just look up. Your help is on the way. Jennifer's going to sing it for us, and you can join her as you feel like you can. Let's sing, Turn Your Eyes.
So are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see, but just one look at the Savior is life more abundant and free. So just look up, your help is on the way. Turn your eyes up.
Let's pray together. Lord, help us to turn our eyes upon you, to see you for who you are, really are, to see your love for us, to see the power that you have, and see your care of us. Sometimes we look out and all we see is the enemy. All we see is how bad things are. All we see is the struggle. We see whatever mountain is before us. Lord, help us to see you for who you really are, who, just how much you care for us. Lord, I pray if there's anyone, really, I know we're all kind of need, we either need a fresh look at you, fresh eyes that see you at work in our life, or we've never come before you before, to you before, and ask for forgiveness. You just put our trust in you. That's what you ask us to do, is just turn our eyes towards you, to take our eyes off the things of this world and to put them squarely on you. Lord, help us. Help us. Only a glance away, really, in you. Thank you, Lord. We praise your name today. We thank you again for your presence in this service. Continue to work in us and through us, Lord. Give us a good week in you. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you all for watching. Thank you for coming this week. You have a great, great week, and we'll see you later. Bye-bye.